Scientists prove that we live in the Matrix.
Bravo 6 to 1-2. Yep, we've secured the studio. This is movie news. Terrorist takeover. Joker cinematographer Lawrence Schurz says that Warner Brothers threatened to have him executed for his plan to shoot the hit super comic book movie of all time in 70mm.
The studio wanted to keep costs down and profit high.
Yes. In other news, Joker is the most profitable comic book movie ever made.
What? How?
Well, it is.
Punch you in the face.
Rumors say the creators and cast of the 90s television sensation Friends are bringing it back.
What is Friends?
It is terrible.
So no one told you I was gonna swing that way. Fans of the hit actor Johnny Depp want Amber Heard cancelled from Aquaman 2.
They say that seeing her on screen is a form of abuse. Yeah.
That's actually hell insensitive, bro.
I'm not black.
Original film Dr. Sleep made half its projected earnings in its opening weekend.
LOL. Critics say the name was too obscure. Why isn't it called something like Shining Part 2? Little Danny is a big D. Why isn't it called Shining Version Shining 2, but this time he's on a bicycle, and then Shining 3, he's on a unicycle. Why don't they call it Shining 2, double the wheels, triple the trouble, and he's a six-wheeler, and he's in a big truck.
Milk?
James Dean is being resurrected with the power of computers for his fourth major feature film role.
Yes, his family was paid lots of money to say they thought it was a great idea.
Yeah, but you're not a jabroni, so you don't believe them.
Neither does Chris Evans, neither does Elijah Wood, neither does Velda Williams, neither does David Moore.
The director defended the decision and the studio went on about how they were so excited to resurrect more dead skeletons.
Zombies, computer brains.
What's up, little guy?
I thought movie news would be less depressing without Disney stories.
You moron. Movie news is terrible, and so are you.
It's only been terrible because we're not the regular hosts, we're the terrorists.
Oh, what are we terrorists for?
The government.
We're terrorists for the government?
Against the government.
Against the government? What? Doing what?
Terrorizing.
And now, a Christmas music special.
Baby, it's cold. I'm struggling to see. The weather's cooling off. My eyes are hurting me. You better put on a jacket. I think I'm going blind.
Roman.
What if JavaScript was evil? Would it be scary? No. Nightmare Code is a 2014 movie directed by Mark Netta. Mr. Netta is obviously most well known for this video he posted on his Instagram. Very cool, Mark. The premise of the movie is that this geezer named Cotton has created a hell-sick program. The only problem is, Cotton is a bit of a Eugene, so he ends up blapping a few of his workmates before offing himself. The company then has to hire someone to fix/finish the rest of the program. And it's got to be done quick, man. Everything is riding on this.
I just have to finish the project. It just has to ship.
And then he'll help?
Then everything bad goes away.
The gimmick of this film is that all the shots are from the point of view of a security camera or someone's laptop camera sort of thing. And when you realise the whole movie is going to be like this, you think this might actually get annoying. But it doesn't really. It actually fits quite well and is rather impressively executed.
Roper harvests multiple input streams, surveillance video, phone conversations, etc.
The vibe of this movie kind of feels like one of those Doctor Who episodes that doesn't actually have the Doctor in it. It's kind of cheap, it's not of the highest quality, but it's still enjoyable, and you have to appreciate the effort put into it, and that it's something different. In terms of actual horror, it really is not scary, and it definitely delves into the cringe territory a little bit. But not in a way that hurts, in a way that's funny, when I don't think it's supposed to be funny. But then I don't know if it's supposed to be scary either, and maybe it is meant to be a little bit funny. And that's a problem the movie can have, is its tonal consistency. It often changes moods really quickly before you really had time to know how you should be feeling. But being that this is old mate Mark's first and so far only written movie, it can be forgiven. I found this movie on Steam, and it definitely helps to watch it closer on a computer screen rather than somewhere far away on a couch watching it on the TV. Helps you get more immersed, as if you're watching this collection of CCTV that someone's put together into a coherent story. So, if you come across the movie, I would say it's for sure worth a watch. Hey yo. Hey Cotton Bro, how you going? Yeah, not told on to watch it, yep. Nah, should be good. Alright mate, I'll see you on the other side. Alright. Nightmare Code by Mark Netter. What's your opinion?
Oh, it was interesting.
Hmm.
Made a lot of sacrifices in terms of the sort of thriller genre to get that multi-cam, you know, security camera look.
Mm-hmm.
And that really dissipated a lot of the tension.
Yeah.
But, you know, as sort of an experimental film, it was interesting.
So, would you say it's worth a watch?
Yeah, if you're interested in weird stylistic things, it's kind of nifty. The trilby really does suck.
It's a terrible hat.
It is quite an awful hat.
Okay, right.
We agree. We agree on the hat thing. And we agree that it's not particularly scary.
No, but it is, by definition, Eugene. Took me about 4 seconds to fall in love with this movie. I knew nothing about it until I saw it just now, but dear me, was it incredibly good, man. Yeah. Three DVD supercharged action thrillers.
That's correct.
A History of Violence, Harsh Times, Running Scared.
Mm-hmm.
Bought this pack at Big W for like $9, and I watched them, and then we watched them again over the last couple of days. Okay, well, I would recommend all these movies.
I wouldn't say any of these are great movies, but I would say...
I'd say Running Scared is a great movie.
You should definitely watch Running Scared, because it is crazy.
It's great. It's ADHD to the max. And these other two, I think Harsh Times can be great, and it's very... It's almost difficult.
The others have some interesting ideas. I wouldn't say that they... really merit a watch as much as Running Scared does.
Yeah, fair. Okay, so A History of Violence, Viggo Mortensen. He's a family man. His name is Tom Stoll. He's, you know, working at the diner, selling coffee. He's got like a little farm. He's got his missus and he's got his two kids. One of his kids in high school. One of his kids is a little girl. So Viggo's character and his wife, they're in love. They've been married for freaking 17 years, however old the son is probably.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden, there's a bit of a problem in the diner. These two men come in, which are established early on in the movie, like the first scenes. No, don't give it to me. I don't want it. These two men come in, and they're bad guys, which because they've been established in the start. And then later on in the movie, they come to the diner, where Viggo works, and they cause a little hassle. They're like, we need the money, because we're broke as heck. Pull out guns. We're like, we're going to show you how serious we are. About to kill some fools. Viggo gets the glass coffee cup, smashes it in the side of his head. He's like, oh, damn. And then he like dives across the counter, he puts some bullets in the younger guy, and then he gets a nice, beautiful headshot on the older guy, which was a very nice looking shot when he
Oh, Magnifico.
Little freaking hole in his head. It was like, oh, yuck. Viggo Mortensen's character, Tom Stoll, they're like, Tom Stoll is a local hero.
Mm-hmm.
Two men try to rob this place.
And they put it on the TV, and it goes...
He killed him, yeah, and they put him all over crazy. The TV. Just like
and the, they're very meticulous about saying, local hero, Tom Stoll, and they American show his face. Hero.
Yes,
American
yes.
hero.
And then from that, the next day, this diner that he works at obviously has a lot more business, because everyone's like, oh, they're on the news. And these strange-looking guys in suits and stuff come over. They're like, how's it going? Joey, talking to Tom Stoll.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? My name's Tom. These guys are part of Tom Stoll's old life.
Basically, his past catches up to him and it's just him cleaning up his past.
Yeah. So what are your opinions on a history of arts?
So, in my opinion, I wouldn't call it a supercharged action thriller, personally.
Fair.
It's pretty low-key for
it is, visiting is very low-key. It's yeah. rather quiet, almost.
Mm-hmm.
The way it feels to me is we could have had a movie like other movies where it shows this hardcore badass dude who's really good at killing, and he kills a bunch of people. And he goes out at the end of the movie, he's like, I don't want to be a part of this life anymore. He goes out to the desert, and he kills this character known as Joey and becomes Tom Stoll, which is what he talks about.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of that, they gave us this movie... which is more of an aftermath of that kind of life.
Yeah.
And so, you know, 17 years, having years down the track, his old life has caught up to him. And we get that sort of story instead, which is a much smaller, quieter, not as intense film.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a nice little... It's almost like a nice change, a nice pace.
It ended in quite a strange place.
You said that. I think the ending was just fine. It could have given us extra stuff, you know, about his... family life, whatever. I don't think it needed to. I think the way it ended was, he walks back in, it's shown his missus, his wife, has almost sort of kicked him out. She's like, piss off.
Mm-hmm.
Joey, when his name was, you know, her name's Stoll, when she's married this dude, he's got a fake name now, her whole name is a lie. So she was pretty upset with that. And because we were showing the movie their loving relationship, and how much she cares about him, he walks in, the little kid, his little daughter, gives him his dinner,
mm-hmm.
and he sits down and he eats dinner with the family. And I guess that gives us the idea that things are going to sort of return back to normal.
But in terms of the flow of the film and the way it was paced out,
mm-hmm.
it just didn't feel like it was meant to end there. And okay. It's interesting because it's a 90-minute film. It's 91 minutes.
It doesn't waste any time.
It doesn't. Well, maybe it does.
All right.
Because... well, they spend a fair chunk of the movie sort of going over this question of whether he's Joey or not. It just felt a little pointless.
Yeah, well, it's just a story for me. It's
everything like, came full circle.
Does it have a moral? No. But it's just a cool little story.
Doesn't really have anything to say. And it's not really a great action film as such.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. But I thought it was just a nice little story that works as a movie. A short movie. Like, if this was, you know, 2.5 hours long, I'd be like, well, what are you going to waste all my time for?
Not telling it need a little more to yeah. it.
But being what it is, a short, you know, 90-minute movie, it tells this, you know, fun little story, and it does well with it. It's got some great long takes, some great, you know, camera movements and cinematography sort of thing.
And, there's some decent cinematography.
Yeah, so they did quite well with it, I thought. Mm-hmm. It feels quite real almost, you know?
You either expect there to be more action or there should be more exploration of the family life.
Yeah.
It felt like it was ramping up, and then nothing.
The climax was pretty good, and then it just kind of, he's cleaned up his old life. So yeah, the action, it's not, is it supercharged? No, it's definitely not. Is it quiet, and is it realistic, and does it work? Yes, it does.
I don't think they really thoroughly explore the fact that he's got this double life to the extent that they should.
Okay, well, but the thing is, he hasn't got a double life anymore.
That's true.
He never had a double life. He had Joey and he has Tom Stoll. And he killed Joey in the desert, whatever. And so now he's got this different life, which is... He's not been, like, training and stuff. He just has these skills from his old life.
Maybe it's just not a very good setup.
Well, I think there's that mystery there, and we have everything we need to have. So I think as its own little story of his old life coming back to haunt him, I think it works.
Who would you recommend it to?
I would recommend it to somebody who wants to... harsh times. Executive produced by Christian Bale, which is quite cool.
And starring Christian Bale.
Yes, this movie is it's about this dude who's just a high maintenance, really terrible guy, to be honest.
Basically.
And
he's just an arsehole.
He's got a friend.
We call him Fredo.
But his name's Mike. Yeah, so they follows these guys for a couple of days as they try and he tries to find work. Old mate's getting, you know, talking to the cop, see if he's gonna become a cop. And he's the kind of guy you do not want to be a cop.
Right.
You don't know what this guy to be.
He's a psycho. And that's stated thoroughly.
Yeah, because he comes from, he's like, you know, been in
a
war.
Military background, and he's seen things, yes. And they have done things to him. For a chunk of the movie, they're just driving around LA, just doing stuff.
Yeah.
Pretending to look for work.
It's basically just character stuff. Does this movie have a plot?
Well, they drive around. He's trying to sell off this gun he's got.
Yeah, so it's a very character-driven movie, I think. That has not so much a plot. There's characters with goals.
Yep.
And we follow around and they just develop these characters.
And we should probably mention that Christian Bale's got a wife in Mexico. A girlfriend in Mexico.
Yes, wanting to be a wife so we can take her over to America.
Yeah.
It's a lot about PTSD, almost, from this main character, dude.
Mm-hmm.
As the movie goes on, he kind of gets crazier and crazier because he finds out things he's not happy about, and things that aren't good for him really affect him in a negative way. Mm-hmm. And I think the movie does quite a good job of showing us that.
So he's a bit of an outlaw, and he wants to become a cop, and he's mm-hmm. looking for work as a cop, and the LAPD they're not so keen on him.
But then he gets a call from old mate Homeland Security or some private security, whatever that is. I thought Homeland was not even real. I thought it was like just for the Punisher Netflix show. But so basically this movie, it's basically following these two dudes over a couple of days as they sort of go on an adventure. Mike's trying to find work, so he's not just all alone. And so his wife's not doing the one doing all the work.
Yeah, but Batman sort of co-ops him and...
Stop calling him Batman.
No. Mike wants to find a job, but Batman wants to do drugs and sell his gun. And he's like, hey, Mike, come with me instead of finding a job. And,
it's a bit more complicated than that, but yeah.
And so he's basically the start of the plot is him trying to find someone to sell this gun to.
Mm-hmm. And they're like, oh, Tyson is in town. He'll buy the gun off you. So they're like, oh, let's go to Tyson's house. So they go there. Tyson's like, what's up? They're like, you want to buy this piece for $300? And he's like, hell yeah, I do. Oh, whoa. Kneecap and shit. Oh, step off and get blasted. he buys it. I like Tyson's character.
He loves life.
Yeah,
he loves shooting people.
He doesn't shoot anyone.
He doesn't, but you know, he'd like to shoot yeah. someone.
Well, I think he acts tougher than he is.
Yeah, that's definitely true.
He's a very, Tyson's a very lovable guy.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, oh, it's Friday night, let's go clubbing and stuff. And Christian Bale's like, no, we're not clubbing, boys.
We're going to Mexico.
And they're like, yeah, Mexico! Yeah.
So what do you think of the setup of Harsh Times?
You know, I think it all works. You know, like, it's not, like I said, it's not so much of a plot, but everything sort of connects up. There's some almost random things that happen, like they're trying to sell this gun, and then someone gets killed, shanked in the neck, and you think they'd be random, but it kind of just shows us the world. So there's some crazy things going on. Them trying to sell this gun is what comes to old mate Christian Bale's demise. They go to Mexico, they realise that his wife and that they've got like this beautiful place.
But he has to leave her because he's going to Colombia. And he makes the career over love decision.
Mm-hmm. So this is my career.
But then when he's in Mexico, he finds out that she's pregnant.
So yeah, that makes him go even more trippy, he starts to lose his mind even more. And this guy's absolutely losing it at this point, like he's not okay at all. He almost kills his wife, his missus with a gun. And it's all quite emotional, quite hardcore to watch really. And they're like, bro, we're getting out of Mexico. So they get out of Mexico, they drop Tyson off. And then Christian Bale's like, okay, now we're going to go sell this weed. Mm. And Mark's like, what freaking weed is that I got?
It's just
like 20 kilos in the
one
bank.
Thing after another.
Yeah, it just gets more and more crazy. And then Christian Bale pulls a gun on Mike, and Mike is not happy with that at all. He's like, bro, I'll never pull a gun on you, man. And he's like, I'm sorry, man, I'm losing my mind. I'm going to take you back home. And he's like, no. Because he's a brother. Mike is a fantastic friend. Mm-hmm. Like, this dude is for real, man. He's a brother. He's a bro. He's like, no, I'm going with you. You're not going to mess this up because you're losing your mind. We're going to go sell this dope, and I'm going to go back home afterwards. Everything's going to be happy ever after. So go do this job. And this is where everything falls apart to the most extent. He starts killing everyone. And then Mike's like, bro, what are you doing? Comes the one guy left who's unarmed. And he's like, bro, please, please. And Mike's like, let's go. And he freaking shoots him. And then he gets in the car and they start driving off. And Mike's like, why'd you do that, man? And because he took those extra few seconds in shooting that guy, that's pretty much what brings to the demise.
So what did you think about Harsh Times?
Well, I mean, maybe, I remember earlier you said to me, if I just like every movie, I'm going to sound like a hack. But I like this movie. Like, there's a lot of times we noticed where the guys aren't even in focus.
Yeah.
A lot of it, like, looks kind of rough.
It does. And we were watching a DVD transfer, which is obviously standard definition.
Kind of weird-ass TV, to be honest.
It's a big TV.
Yeah.
And obviously... Well, not obviously. A bunch of this film was shot in 16mm on probably pretty fast film. So it was very grainy and it looked pretty murky on this transfer.
Murky, key, 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 key.
You also have weird things where for some reason you got two guys and only one of them's in focus, but they're both talking to each other.
Yeah. It's quite harsh looking at points.
Mm-hmm.
But it fits the movie, which is a kind of dirty... makes you feel uneasy the whole time because you're just constantly on edge because of the way these guys are acting. Like, if he was just a nice, normal guy, then, well, you would never freaking movie, would you? But because this guy's so damn crazy and he's got PTSD, that's what drives this movie is, you know, their actions that he makes and the consequences from those actions. And, I think it all sort of makes sense. It shows his PTSD well enough by having some crazy sort of, you know, moving stuff going on.
That was an interesting thing that came up whenever he had... a panic attack, I guess.
And they showed it quite well, I thought.
And that's a nice little visual motif. It shows you what's going on inside his head. And that's what this is really about.
Is this, guy losing his mind over time. Obviously, focus your camera next time. But I think it's excusable.
Sure.
And the shot, you said it was kind of weird when, you know, the old guy at the end shoots a shotgun and it follows the bullets, which is the car. I don't know how they did that. I thought it was a pretty damn cool shot. And the style of it was very good, I thought. It was quite, fairly stylish.
Mm-hmm.
Not quite as stylish as the next movie. Running Scared.
Running Scared.
What an absolute ADHD trip. What a fantastic movie.
Running Scared might be the worst film I've ever seen.
It's not.
No, it's not. But it is a terrible, terrible film in a wonderful... wonderful way.
You can't just say it's terrible because it's crazy.
It is terrible.
It's everything they intended it to be. So can you say it's bad when it's exactly their intentions?
Yeah. Because maybe their intentions are stupid.
Well, I disagree completely. It's a crazy movie, but terrible? Absolutely not. It's ADHD. It's trippy as heck.
Why don't we explain the concept of
Running Scared? So basically what happens is everything happens.
Everything.
There's mobs going on, mm-hmm. There's dirty cops, there's pedophiles, there's ice rinks, there's crazy Russian dads, there's meth labs. Everything about crime is in this movie.
So what's the basic premise? What's the basic plot line?
The setup, which you said is a very good setup. You said, that's a good setup, which it is, it's different, is... Paul Walker, rest in peace. Joey is in this kind of crazy deal that went wrong and a bunch of dirty cops got shot, especially with this gun. And then he hides a gun in his basement, which his kid and his kid's friend sees. And then his kid friend steals his gun, shoots his dad with it because his dad was beating his wife.
John Wayne was a faggot.
And the neighbors, by the way. And then runs away because he shot his freaking dad in the cop shop. And basically Joey, Paul Walker, has to get this gun back because if it gets found, then Paul Walker is in trouble.
Mm-hmm. So everyone wants the gun.
And everyone wants to find the kid who has the gun.
Yep.
And so a bunch of crazy things happen, which I'm not even going to get into. just because it's too crazy, and I recommend you watch it, so I'd rather not spoil it completely.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very stylized. There's a lot of camera movements where I'm like, bro, how do you even do that, man?
It is extremely stylized to the point of looking terrible. It looks like someone vomited all over the screen.
In a beautiful way. Like the
in
food
a that, crazy, wonderful way.
Like they vomited on the screen, but the food that they ate before that was just, you know, very vibrant and very beautiful. Mm-hmm. And you're like, oh, that's not so bad.
Cool. It's salad vomit.
Yeah, it's very colourful in terms of the brightness. The lighting is very, very bright on people's faces when they're talking and stuff.
It's very high contrast. It looks like someone just took it into the into color and they just turned up a contrast slider and said, okay, that's fine.
Well, like I said before, they didn't really have time to edit the movie because the movie's so crazy, so fast paced, they get so immersed into the characters not having all this time that they don't have time themselves. Now that's a lie because they obviously put a lot of work into editing this movie because a lot of the transitions and stuff and a lot of
there's some crazy moves. Stuff. But even just it feels very dreamlike. You have moments where someone's walking, just walking over, and they have to like just cut ahead every few seconds in terms of where he is.
But it's never, it's not frustrating. Like it's not,
I think it's
not Liam Neeson jumping over a fence in Taken 3, you know? It's like, it's stylized, it's purposeful. The action is well done. You know, when he's getting smacked in the face with the ice.
It's very, there are a lot of quick cuts. It's not necessarily clear all the time what's going on.
I think it's fairly clear. Like, especially like,
well, where people are in position to each other.
Okay.
I would say.
But it's not disorientating, I wouldn't say. I reckon it's not disorientating.
I think it is.
It's very enjoyable. Like, you will not be bored. I can guarantee you that. It's not like
that's true.
If you want to go down the turbo route, which I wouldn't do. But like if you want to say, oh, it's terrible, like The Room, whatever, where it can be boring, it's not. This movie is purposely made to be just absolute trip. And if you want to watch a movie where you're just like, ah, then Ronnie Scared is the movie for you.
It's a ridiculous film.
Mm.
Will you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's a ridiculous, ridiculous film. And but if that's what you're into, then
yeah, but it's fantastic.
Definitely watch it. And what's your favorite part of Running Scared?
Probably, I mean, I do love the part, like you said, like the subplot with the pedophiles. Mm.
There's a little subplot. And I don't want to spoil everything, but Joe's wife gets her own little investigation.
It's literally a side quest.
It is.
Like you said, it's literally a side quest, but because this movie is so insane, it fits.
Mm-hmm.
It fits perfectly well.
Yeah. It bears virtually zero impact on the plot. I mean, it does a little bit. But they could have easily done that in a 2-minute sequence rather than...
But I'm glad they didn't. I'm glad they did how they did it.
It was a wonderful little tangent. And as soon as it's over, I was like, all right, we have a main story
mate,
to follow.
We've still got a whole other thing going on here.
Yeah.
So yeah, it literally for a minute, it almost turned into another movie, but because it's still the same sort of style.
Yeah, and that's like, much... I think that's a better movie, to be honest.
I think it did what it needed to do.
It's a bit of a detective story.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But
and
if it was
builds a bit of tension, and it's like the director was like, okay, I want to make this feature film, but I've also got a short film idea.
Yeah.
Why don't we just do it all as one film?
And he did that, and I think it worked perfectly well. You recommend Running Scared? I recommend Running Scared. Let's talk about how the movies work as a pack.
Mm-hmm. Well, these movies were never meant to go together.
But I think I'm very happy that I found them together at BW
for
$9 a packet. Because were they meant to go together? Yeah, of course not. What even brings them together in the first place? The fact that they were all from 2006, maybe?
All from around the same time period.
When does this one come from?
They're kind of the same genre, but not really.
Running Scared is definitely a supercharged action thriller. Are the other two? Not so much. They all kind of fit because they have the kind of different vibe about them. And like as action movies, you're not going to watch one of these and then watch a second one and be like, oh my goodness, I'm just watching the same thing. Oh yeah.
No, that's
like,
true.
It's a good variation on the action genre.
Yeah, it's an interesting little triple feature.
And so if you specifically find this pack for a reasonable price, like $9 like I did, absolutely I'd say pick it up and watch them all.
How would you rank these movies?
Okay, one thing I'll say that brings them together that I enjoy about all these movies is how involved the wife characters always are. The woman characters, like in History of Violence, she's very involved and, you know, she's an integral part of the actions of Viggo. Eva Longoria, the wife, her character as the wife of Mike,
mm-hmm.
You know, sort of pushes the movie along, pushes the plot along as well, some of it. Is a big part of Mike's character. And then also in Running Scared, the wife character, she's also very involved.
And she's the best character in the movie.
I think Paul Walker's a fantastic character. I think he does excellent in this movie.
But she's better.
No, I don't think so. I think either of them are better than the other. I think they work perfectly well together and they're just as good as each other.
Wrong.
Which one was that from?
That was from Running Scared. Actually,
Running Scared. Who said that?
Was it Richard Nixon?
I don't know. Anyway, raw. Just how involved she is to the point of having her own like side quest, which was a fantastic addition to the movie.
Yeah.
So, to wrap it up, as a pack, I think they work very well. Good difference. The only thing to me that really draws them together is the involvement in the wife characters, how they're all quite involved. Otherwise, it's just it's a good. Each film is quite different from each other, so
I'd say A History of Violence has a decent concept, but it doesn't feel complete to me. And it feels like maybe this is the wrong story to tell with these characters. Or maybe they just didn't go far enough.
Mm-hmm.
Harsh Times feels a lot more complete, but the concept wasn't as strong in my... Well, the concept was all right, I just didn't care about it as much.
Okay.
Running Scared was bonkers. And
bonkers.
It's a wonderful, wonderful, terrible film.
Minus the word terrible.
John Wayne was a faggot.
MAM
5.
Intergalactic.